You are about to view a videotape of the movie Prairie Wings, which was filmed by Mr. Edgar Queeny over 40 years ago at Wingmead in Roe, Arkansas. Mr. Queeny's book, by the same name, was illustrated by the wildlife artist Mr. Dick Bishop. The purpose of this project was twofold. First, we wanted to capture the quality of the original film on videotape, so that its unique beauty can be retained indefinitely. Second, to make the tape available to wildlife lovers through Ducks Unlimited. You can generate dollars for ducks by owning your own personal tape. Mr. Queeny was chairman of the board for Monsanto Chemical Company and a great outdoorsman. He produced many wildlife films. However, this film has been described as follows. Prairie Wings can truly be called the most engrossing picture of American wildfowl ever conceived. To appreciate Mr. Queeny's love of nature, you should read chapter one of his book, Prairie Wings, entitled Between Season Nostalgia. The last paragraph is especially appropriate. And in those of us who derive enjoyment from the flight of wildfowl and who know Arkansas's grand prairie, a wistful nostalgia for its pin oak flats simmers and simmers throughout spring and summer months. It boils over when the first yellow leaf of autumn whispers that the hunting winds are on their way. And when the woodlands along the White River are ablaze with red and orange tints, and the air tastes tangy with frost, the call of the prairie and its denizens is insistent, siren-like, almost hypnotic. There is only one anecdote to respond.
Behind us, and the hunting winds lead us to the heart of Arkansas's grand prairie. Here we follow the waters of Bayou Legrue, which meander through the prairie, and the eye is enchanted by all the tints and hues of fall. Imagine, if you can, crisp, cool air laden with sweet odors, and a silence so deep that all memory of sound seems lost. The multicolored foliage and the quiet, tawny waters seem to be listening. Listening and waiting for the vast avian flights which invade the Grand Prairie every fall. Here they form one of the greatest concentration of wildfowl on this continent. The Grand Prairie is the heart of the Mississippi Flyway. To escape the frigid cold as summer dies and reach areas where food is abundant, wildfowl follow the waters south. Geese leave Baffin Island, cross Lake Erie, then follow the Wabash in Ohio to the Mississippi. Mallards from Alaska follow the Platte and the Missouri. Ducks from the Canadian prairie provinces follow the father of waters itself. All of the flyways of the huge Mississippi basin converge toward Arkansas's Grand Prairie. So, a very large part of the North American continent's wildfowl hold their fall meetings here. In the region's great rice fields, they find a bountiful food supply. Rice kernels scattered during the harvest lie waiting. At twilight, thousands of ducks leave the shelter of flooded pin oak flats and fly to the rice fields. Like swarms of blackbirds, they feed and mill over these fields at night. And at dawn, with their crops full of rice, they make their way back to the flats. They've been reported to fly 360 miles between dusk and dawn. At this speed, their flight is so swift that to our human eyeing technique is their color obscure. To give our sight a new dimension, we use slow motion cameras that permit us at will to reduce their speed to visible action. Here they are, returning to the Pin Oak Flats where they found a quiet spot for a day's siesta. They settle like autumn leaves. Most of them enjoy a little gossip on the night's doings. Naturally, when so many members of the duck family meet, they have much to say. Listen. Like most relatives, members of the duck family differ in many ways. Here is the universal duck, ancestor of domesticated ducks, the mallard. But although mallards are common to all regions, their appearance is far from commonplace. The mallard drake has a head of brilliant color. According to the light, it sometimes appears as turquoise blue, sometimes iridescent green. Will the model please turn? Thank you. Your appearance is too beautiful to hide. His takeoff is power, and he flies through the air with the greatest of ease. By comparison, the man on the flying trapeze is clumsy. The mallard hen's colors, quiet and subdued, serve as camouflage. She blends with her nest and hides it to protect her young. Here are the pintails, first to come south in autumn, first to fly north in spring. Seemingly frail, in quiet air, this bird can coast down from the heavens without flexing a single muscle. It's not difficult to see why these birds are called pintails. The drake's two central tail feathers are long, black, and pointed. Incidentally, in defense of her young, the pintail hen is one of the most courageous of all wildfowl. The call of Woody. Drake is a gorgeous assembly of color in subtle blends. These swift and erratic flyers are ringnecks. The white bands on their bills are good field marks. That's why they're sometimes called ringbills. The hen is identified by a white cheek patch. From their color, they're also known as blackjacks. Without any cautious circling, this drake boldly dives in for a perfect landing. Like all diving ducks, the ringnecks do a running takeoff. The bills of these shovelers explain their names. They're also called spoonbills and shovel nose. In full nuptial dress, this spoonbill drake is a handsome fella. And the spoonbill hen doesn't mind his shovel nose. She has one too. This conservative couple are black ducks. In certain kinds of light, their color is quite sober. As the light changes, the color has depth and sheen. The drake adds a decorative touch with his orange-colored bill and his flashing white underwings. Here's a ball-pate drake. As he takes off, watch the top of his head. Does seem bald, doesn't it? The last migrants to arrive in the south are the green-winged teal. They're the smallest of all North American ducks. White undersides and green wing patches give them a delicate look. Yet, they're very hardy, and their speed surpasses that of all other ducks. Now, the goose honks high. Their flight can be highly disciplined. Perfect V formation. Each keeps clear his view ahead and avoids the other's airstream. Very military. Yet their flight will vary from the military to the seemingly effortless grace of ballet. Preparing to land, this group brings to mind three ballet dancers bowing to the audience. And quickly the ballet pose is dropped, and they assume the unity and precision of amphibious planes as they near the water. As they take to the air, their clangor fills the air. Yes, in autumn, the Grand Prairie is enriched by countless numbers of wildfowl. Here they fly, here they dine and rest. But a raft of ducks is often disturbed, for the hunting winds lure other live creatures to the bayous, the hunters. They set out in the early morning frost to spend the day in the Pin Oak Flats, an exciting day which will bring all their skill and patience to play. Duck hunting was certainly known in ancient Egypt and has been practiced for millenniums, but methods change with time and even now vary to match the region's nature. In Arkansas's Pin Oak Flats, no blinds are needed. The trees serve as blinds, but also present handicaps. If the ducks don't settle down into the decoys, they're vulnerable for only a brief instant as they fly past. Many types of calls are used to lure them in. The call over water to attract them from a distance. The feeding call as the ducks come closer. The lonesome call, begging for company. Ankle deep in water, hunters call and patiently wait. I see the man on the left ruffles the water's surface, simulating its condition if ducks were present. Here they come. Two large trees in the background. You probably didn't see the duck fall, but as the retriever is sent to fetch, he will surely find it.
Oh, now, wait a minute.
One, two, three,
claim
that duck.
You didn't use that.
Much game brought down in dense cover is unnecessarily lost without skilled retrievers. When the hunter's aim is unerring, a retriever's job is routine. But the mallard drake he holds now engaged all the retriever's speed and skill. The gunner's shot hit a wing and nearly crippled the bird. Watch how it happened. Wing. The left wing is broken.
Over there. They're coming right over here.
This is the kind of performance that makes a hunter proud of his dog. With such a retriever, very few ducks are lost. And soon, all over the region, gunners have brought down their limits and prepare to leave. Yet, millions of ducks and geese remain in flight. Thanks to nature's bounty and resilience, thanks to the conservation measures of Ducks Unlimited and all the wildlife conservation agencies, we know that every year, vast flights will pay their autumnal visit to Arkansas's Grand Prairie. Man's eye has followed the flight of birds for centuries. And thousands of years ago, he began his attempt to imitate. The Greeks told how Icarus fashioned wings of wax and did fly, but the sun melted his wings and he was lost. Of course, we do fly now. We've even surpassed birds in speed and power. But we shall never match them in grace and sureness. With their speed reduced to extreme slow motion, many details of their masterful flight technique become clearly visible. In cruising flight, the wings move rhythmically forward and downward, and then backward and upward. Focus your eye on this drake's wingtip and notice its cycle, a figure eight pattern. The backward flip of the wing takes place in about half the time of the downbeat. Note the backward flip as she pitches. The leading edge of the wing is down first in the downstroke. Wing beat arcs vary, much as human strides. Now here, the arc is so wide, her wingtips almost meet on the downbeat. Moving wings takes power, and it comes from the breast region. There, the powerful pectoral muscles work smoothly under the skin. These muscles can move freely because they're attached not to the skin, but to the breastbone. More than 1,000 small muscles control the tail. It can be opened, convex, and down. Like this one, as she changes position. This convex tail helps her steady herself. And here, as the legs balance, the tail is concave. Note the leg function. The legs go back sympathetically with each downbeat as the duck accelerates. To preserve her balance, her legs swing from side to side. But in cruising flight, legs are drawn up into the under tail coverts, and then the body is fully streamlined. Here, the wind is ruffling tertials and body coverts. Notice the pintail's coordination of all her instruments of flight. She raises a convex tail, drops her legs, then raises right wing above left, left above right, and swings off. Yes, it's perfect aerodynamic balance. Ornithologists say the bird's inner ear structure indicates a highly developed sense of balance. As she comes into land with head lowered, her tail is brought forward. Bird's balance is so perfectly controlled that they can even fly upside down. In the next scene, watch the teal on the left. Watch closely. Upside down to effect a trick turn. But it still retains its balance. When ducks land, they always face the wind. If the wind shifts, they maneuver crosswind to their landing. Wings, tails, and feet are all brought into play. In slow motion, it seems so effortless. Look, Ma, no hands. As he stops short, tail and wings perform an excellent job of braking. Even his webbed feet are spread wide to squarely meet the wind. Of course, sometimes balance is lost. Whoops. But as you see, it's soon recovered. He comes in for his usual landing, his feet reaching forward like pontoons. Ducks prefer to keep their wings dry. And as they land, the wings are held high above the water and then neatly folded. The duck's takeoff is equally efficient. Contrary to most thinking, river and pond ducks don't jump out of water. They fly out. Mighty down thrusts of wings on the water's surface give them flight. And there's such power in the takeoff that river ducks can actually achieve vertical flight. It seems this one could spiral out of a well if it had to. But unlike river and pond ducks, these two ruddy ducks do a running takeoff. From what seems a master's painting. Yes, man is bewitched by the color and grace of birds, the sound of wings as they rise from the water. Man is captivated by the rhythm of a bird in flight. Birds come in to rest, his eyes drawn to the glow of the morning sun on their wings. But the time a man spends in the bayous does more than please his eye. It gives him a strange new insight. As the modern man goes home, many of ancient man's ideas seem less fantastic to him. His mind is full of images. Images which revive the kinship to his ancestors. Many ancients believe that when a man died, his spirit became a bird and flew to the great beyond. The wish was obviously father to the thought. Some believe that trees had souls and that the spirits found a home beneath their sheltering branches. Is it strange that water was considered a gift from heaven? Its rich colors and the bird spirits blend so well. Many primitive beliefs seem so plausible here, with waters, trees, and prairie wings.